Hello. Next item in our agenda is the keynote delivered by Professor Anton. So first, let me introduce you to the speaker. So the Professor Nyholt is received his PhD in computer science from the Vrije University in Amsterdam. He held positions at various universities inside and outside Netherlands. In 1989, he was appointed full professor at the University of Twente in the Netherlands, where he initiated its human media interaction group. During some years, he was scientific advisor of Philips Research Europe. For a few years, he was a global research fellow at the Imaginary Institute of Iskander, Malaysia. In 2018, he became a member of Microsoft Technical Leadership Advisory Board on brain-computer interfaces. His main research interests are multimodal interaction with the focus on entertainment computing, affect human and brain-computer interfacing. Professor Nyholt, together with many of the 50 PhD students he supervised, wrote numerous journal and conference papers on these topics and acted as program chair and general chair of many large international conferences on entertainment computing, virtual agents, affective computing, faces and gestures, multimodal interaction, computer animation, and brain-computer interfaces. More recently, he exposed the topics in augmented reality environments, and Professor Nyholt is the chief editor of the specialty section, Human Media Interaction, of the journals Frontiers in Psychology and Frontiers in Computer Science. He is also series editor of the Springer book series on gaming media and social effects. He's also social effect. Recent edited books include the 2019-2020 books, Making Smart Cities More Playable, Exploring Playable Cities, and Brain Art, Brain-Computer Interfaces for Artistic Expression. His keynote today, titled as Making Smart Cities More Playable. Professor Nyholt, I invite you to deliver the keynote address. Over to you, sir.
Okay. You can hear me now?
Yes, we can hear.
Yes. Okay, well, I'm happy to be here. I will share my screen. Let me see. Where do I have it? Okay. Well, as I said, I'm very happy to be here, but of course, I would prefer to be in Sri Lanka. So good afternoon, Sri Lanka. Good afternoon, Colombo. And good afternoon, the conference. So I have a subtitle, Turning Ubiquitous Smartness into Ubiquitous Playability. I will first talk about smart cities. And maybe after one third of my talk, I will go to playability. The talk is non-technical, so I will give a lot of examples. Sometimes I can imagine that you find some of these examples rather strange, but please keep in mind it's mostly about experiments, advertising probability, possibilities, things like that. So. Not all the applications I will show you are really serious. But of course, it's about playability, so it doesn't have to be serious. So these are some of my recent books. And well, you notice the word play, playful, playability, entertainment is there. So that's really one of my interests, play, interaction, fun, humor, and of course, digital technology. So towards smart cities. Well, what has happened is, of course, that civic authorities, so city councils, administrations, they have learned about ubiquitous and pervasive computing, about sensors that can collect behavioral information, and this kind of information is, of course, important for the city. So traffic information, transport, presence in public spaces, management of waste, energy consumption, street noise level, air quality, all these kinds of things. And this information can, of course, be collected, as we all know, using pervasive computing or ubiquitous computing or Internet of Things technology. So technology embedded in public spaces, in workplaces, and in objects and devices that are part of our natural environment. And my emphasis in this talk is about urban environments and public spaces in urban environments. So just to give a first example of what people imagine when they are talking about smart cities. This is from 2017 in San Diego. I will show a video.
San Diego could become the smartest city in the US. San Diego is partnering with General Electric to upgrade the city's streetlights into a digital network that can optimize traffic and enhance public safety. More than 3,000 streetlights in San Diego will be equipped with real-time anonymous sensors, cameras, and microphones. The streetlights will be connected to form an IoT network. The streetlights can measure air quality, locate vacant parking spaces, monitor traffic flow of vehicles and pedestrians, as well as detect gun violence. The city will also replace 14,000 streetlights with technology that allows them to dim or brighten manually or automatically according to natural light conditions. The installation will begin this summer with the potential for 3,000 more sensors to be added in the future.
Okay. This is, of course, the situation in the United States, but we see it also happen in several other countries, for example, Korea, Japan, Malaysia, probably also in Sri Lanka. I don't know about it. But I give a few more examples and also some criticism on smart cities. So this is an example from Wellington, New Zealand. And there the idea was to detect acoustic activity like screaming, shouts, breaking glass, to monitor visual activity like beggars, fighting, or other antisocial behavior, pick up the smells of paint fumes that indicate graffiti. And then the criticism was, of course, well, this is some kind of big brother that is watching us, that is listening to us, that's smelling us. And well, we do not really want these kind of things in our city. So you got this kind of comments in the newspapers. Wellington City says bye-bye to Big Brother technology at the moment that they decided, well, we really don't want to do this. But probably the reason to dismiss this was also that the commercial company, that was NEC Technology, decided that they would refocus their activities, and they stopped the Smart City Partnership. So this was a project, a Smart City project, that was dismissed in 2018. In my hometown, that's Enschede in the Netherlands, we have a lot of bicycles, we have a lot of pedestrian areas, and the city council decided that they want to pick up the smartphones' Wi-Fi signals and then see what kind of routes people take in the city for pedestrians, bicycles, things like that. What were the preferred spots in the city? How many visits were there? Things like that. That's possible. It happened. And interesting was this application. You had a smartphone app. It was connected with the traffic light, and it recognizes the presence of a waiting cyclist. And then the cyclist get priority to pass the light. So the cyclist got green light due to their use of this smartphone app. It's an interesting application if you, consider a situation in a city where you have a lot of cyclists and they don't want to wait for too long for having a green light. And in addition, people that used the bicycle were rewarded. So it was also some kind of activity to get people to cycle, to walk, use public transport instead of using their cars. Again, there was some problem. For example, it turned out that this is not allowed in the Netherlands. So they had to dismiss also this part of the Smart City project. Another, let's say, rather negative thing is that it is possible, it has been shown to be possible, that these kind of systems can be hacked. So, for example, some hackers found a simple way to mess with traffic lights. So by reverse engineering, they found they could cause delays in many cities, not only in the Netherlands, but also, so it's demonstrated here. Okay, the video stops, I think, but... Okay, you don't see the green light happening, the video is too short, but you can imagine that especially in a student, in a university town with a lot of students, people start messing with this kind of technology that is available in public spaces. You can also look at cities that start from scratch, so-called greenfield smart cities. So there are initiatives everywhere to have smart cities that are built from the ground up or from the internet up, you can say. So there was Plan IT Valley in Portugal, Songdo, it exists nowadays in South Korea. There were plans for Toronto, they were also dismissed later, Belmont, Saudi Arabia, etc. So let's go to Toronto for an example. So it was initiated by Google, at least a sister company of Google called Sidewalk. And they, well, were planned to be responsible for the design of a $50 million smart city neighborhood. So not the whole town, just a new neighborhood, or in fact an old neighborhood that had to be rebuilt. And the idea was, in this neighborhood we will have self-driving taxis, taxi bots, garbage robots, flexible buildings, flexible and walkable streets, depending on the weather and on the climate, streets had a certain appearance. You need local weather sensors for that, air quality sensors, noise sensors, and let's say artificial intelligence to take care to become responsible for the flow of the traffic. And of course, the same kind of criticism came there. If you do it in existing city, not everybody will be happy with it. So here was the comment, Google wants to run cities without being elected. Don't let that happen. And you can say that part of this criticism, part of the problems that emerge are because it's not clear who will profit from it. And will the original citizens will have a say in the procedures. So there is no or insufficient information on who will own or have access to the information that's culled from Google Smart City experiment. So is it owned by Google? Is it owned by the city? And what some people said, well, the smart city industry is in fact a Trojan horse for technology companies. And privatization is of course important. So you have the control of public spaces, but the control is privatized. So it is sold to companies, you can say. But of course, if some company, a large company like Google's Sidewalk comes with these kinds of ideas about how the city will look like, well, at first, people, at least the administration, city administrations, they become very enthusiastic. But also in this case, in 2020, the whole project was dismissed, or at least scaled down. So privatized cities, that can be a consequence of having these private cities run, by kind of speaking, by companies instead of by democratic councils. So some people say a smart city is a privatized city. Morozov, for example, he is a well-known technology and future person, futurist, and he was saying cities are becoming too dependent on private companies. So the combination of the smart city is a privatized city. And what you also see that public subsidies are being used for private innovation. So, and companies, you cannot expect that they want to share all data obtained from car parks, traffic lights, flow of cars, etc., that they want to share that or with the city or with their competitors. So they become economic owners of competition-sensitive information. Okay, that was some general remarks about smart cities developments and this distinction between, well, existing cities in which you introduce smart technology and cities that are built from the ground up. Artists have also looked at smart cities and at consequences for smart cities. And also there you can find a critical look, but also a playful look. So for example, these two artists, Jotun Park and David Chemison, they introduced three artistic projects. One has to do with, let's say, traffic signs that can display personal information of people in their proximity, people in the neighborhood. A smart trash can they introduced, and they introduced this smart bench. And we will see what they want to do with these tools, these street furniture effect. So for example, the bench. If you spend too much time on the smart bench, it will dump you off. The trash can. If you throw away the wrong trash, so this is a situation where the trash is separated, then the smart trash can throws it right back at you. And here you have the street sign that displays personalized messages. For example, you stand there with a camera and suddenly the street sign has detected it and denotes it's not allowed to use the camera here. So I give an example of the, let's see, the smart bins. Yep. Okay. What was said is that, in fact, you almost fear that this Benz design may end up in the wrong hands and actually gets commissioned. Well, I gave these examples from Wellington, New Zealand, and this is really coming close. And in fact, you can say it for all these ideas of these artists. So in several cities, you have benches with music and sense and certain parts of public spaces that where the homeless are really, chased away, you can say. They are not able to sit on a bench or to lay on a bench. You sometimes have in some cities in the United States, for example, smells in certain locations or you have certain music that is not that is disliked. And also smart trash cans that reward correct behavior. They are there at some places, not so extreme as in the example that was shown in the previous slide, but it happened. And also street signs that monitor and enforce correct behavior, or traffic lights that are doing that, they exist. I will give some examples. So, for example, in Paris, they had a billboard. It was located near crossings, pedestrian crossings. And the idea was to avoid jaywalking. So I will show the video. I hope you don't get scared by it.
People don't realize how dangerous it is to cross at a red light until an accident happens. More pedestrians are killed or injured in the Paris area than in any other city in Europe. To make the public aware of the danger, the Paris Area Road Safety Authority created a campaign that had an impact. Without impact. The virtual crash billboard, which was placed consecutively at Paris's most dangerous intersections. Here's how it works. A camera in the billboard detects when someone is crossing at a red light, then allows people to place the sound of a car braking in an emergency. Another camera takes a picture of the reaction and displays it on the billboard with the message, "Don't risk looking death in the face." People could then take a pledge not to cross at a red light and contribute that picture to the campaign all over Paris.
Okay, it's rather extreme, and it has not really been implemented, just at a few places to see, to show how it works and to warn people that things like these are possible. So, but in fact, if you look at the situation in China, in several cities in China, if there people cross the street despite that there is a red light, then their picture is taken. They are displayed on a big screen near the crossing, and sometimes there's also facial recognition so that also their names can be displayed. There are examples of this. And in China, of course, it's part of the social credit system. So in Stockholm, not that extreme. I will just show you the video that will be clear. Okay, it will be clear, I think. So smart cities, it's more than logistics. You can do a lot of other things with smartness that is embedded in the city. So logistics, that's clear. It's about efficiency, sustainability, energy, waste, etc. But you can also look at cities, citizens' well-being, of course. So how can it contribute to, and how can citizens benefit from digitally enhanced city management? And trust and privacy and safety are issues that come up in that situation. And you can also look at explicit well-being. So how can you persuade people to play or have a healthy lifestyle? And how can that be supported by the digitally enhanced urban environment? So In the past, we have seen several visions on technology for future cities. Le Corbusier is, of course, a famous name from France. Christopher Alexander in the United States, and in the Netherlands, I mentioned Constant Nieuwenhuis, and there have been many others, of course. For example, these earlier visions of Le Corbusier, he introduced the view of une maison et une machine à habiter. So a house is a machine for living. And he developed a view of house environments where you have some kind of control of the house or a part of the city, an area of the city. And the city is then composed as a collection of machines for living. So he introduced the idea of carefully planned cities, composites of machines for living, who would actually lead to a better, more human urban environment. And in the case of Constant, he was called Constant, he developed a view on a future city that was called New Babylon. And he talked about the Ludic society that was in 1974. And he assumed movable assembly systems and devices for controlling climatic conditions that were accessible, that had to be accessible for everybody. So not only for, let's say, the city administration, the city council, but for people living in the city. And also the use of audiovisual media in order to have this ludic social behavior. So this is an example of a maquette that was built by Constant, and he, well, there's a nice citation about the inhabitants of New Babylon. They wandered through the sectors of New Babylon, seeking new experience, as yet unknown ambiences, and that could be done, should be done, without the passivity of tourists, but fully aware of the power they have to act upon the world, to transform it, recreate it. So that is rather far away from the earlier examples in Wellington or Toronto and, well, cities like Songdo, I think. Michael Sicard, he spoke about cities as machines of play. So his advice was, let's make our cities open for play. Play as joyous revolt, as constructive resistance, as spaces for moments of joy. So let's turn cities into collective instruments for pleasure and resistance. Let's turn cities into machines for playing. So let's say more about play, and I will go a little faster. Well, I still have some time, I think, yeah. Of course, children play. So this is a nice picture. I think it was in Edinburgh in United Kingdom. I think right after the Second World War. Here you have children playing cricket in London. Oh, what I want to say about the previous one. You see that they are using the lamppost. So they are using street furniture to play. We will see more of that. Playing cricket in London. Here you have playing cricket, of course, it's the United Kingdom, so you have to play cricket in Newcastle, 1962. Playing football, of course, this is 1966, a little later. You see the clothes are becoming a little more modern. Older people also play. I have an example of, I think, Italy it is. Oh. Well, it's great that these things are possible, were possible on the street. So the question is, can we make these smart cities also playable, or a little playable, a little more playable? So can we use the smart city technology, the sensors, the actuators? Can we use it to build smart cities that are playful or are playable? So can we use smart technology to make a city playable? So in the next part of my talk, I will just show initiatives and examples, and hopefully it motivates people, it motivates conference attendants, well, to think about possible playable technology embedded in your own city. So this is an old project, 2006, but it's nice because it's so creative. So they had sensors hidden inside coconuts, and the coconuts hung from trees at public locations. It was near the airport, the San Jose airport. And you can complain, of course, if there is too much aircraft noise, if there are too many landings, etc. So there are rules, regulations, but they are not always maintained, but you can complain about it. But in this case, the sensors, they monitor the aircraft noise, and when the noise is excessive, then it triggered an automated telephone call to the airport's complaint line. Here's a more recent example. Again, it's from an artist, Simon Weckert. It is in Berlin, and he used a handcart full of smartphones to trick Google Maps traffic algorithm. Not sure whether you are aware with this algorithm, but when there is a lot of traffic on a particular street, then it can be noted by this Google Map, and other people, other car drivers can decide to take another street. So the idea is, if you have a lot of smartphones, you put them in a cart and you walk in such a street, then car drivers get a message, you should avoid that particular street. That is what's done by this artist. So you see, there are hardly any cars in the streets where this person is walking. So it's a kind of hacking, you can say, but it's playful, it's original, it's nice. Street Pong is a game, everybody knows Pong. It has been installed at a few traffic lights in German towns, and here you can see how it works.
And it's very simple. So we put a touch screen in it, and a Wi-Fi connection, and a game. So now you can play Pong from one side of the street to the other, with a person standing on the other side, also waiting for the light to change. And so you can have a game, have fun while waiting. And when the light changes, when it turns green, the game starts. So there's a winner and a loser, and you meet on the street. And
okay. This is in Lisbon. It's called the dancing traffic light. Again, people have to wait for traffic lights, and how can you persuade them to do so? Thank you.
on the dance. Don't want a coat, no tie, no shirt, and even no pants. I'm on the dance. Shaking your head, well, I'm shaking my ass, cause I'm on the dance. I wanna shake it and shake it and shake it and shake it, shake it, girl. Shake it. Watch me dance now.
This is probably an example that's more well known. It's started, well, in fact, it started in Boston at a museum, but it was brought to public spaces, and in this case to Stockholm, taking the stairs. Again, here the result was that more people took the piano stairs instead of the original, more traditional stairs. The trash can. So put rubbish in the trash can, and the trash can, well, it works like a Tetris game. So you are turning trash disposal into a game. This is an example. I'm not sure where it was. Maybe Australia, I think. It was Australia, yeah. So it's a kind of gamification of the city by introducing this kind of street furniture. I'll skip this because of the time. Well, you see people playing with light. This is an example of prankvertising, so pranking people and combine it with advertising. So here you can see what's happening. So digital screens are equipped with ultrasonic sensors. The train arrival was monitored, and then this was happening on the screen. It's very simple to implement. You can do it everywhere. Many playable city projects are coming from Bristol. And they had this idea, the playable city is imagined as a city in which hospitality and openness are key, enabling residents and visitors to reconfigure and rewrite city services, places and stories. So this goes in the direction of Constant Nieuwenhuis, his Ludic society. So the playable city fosters serendipity and gives permission to be playful in public. And they had a yearly competition of project proposals. So for example, in 2014, you had this idea of shadowing. You have smart street lamps, and the street lamps have cameras, they have processors, and they collect shadows of people walking by. And then at a later moment, when someone else is walking by, the shadow of a previous person or a dog, for example, is projected on the street surface. So here you have two examples that people are seeing a shadow which is completely different from what their shadow should be. So they recorded more than 100,000 shadows, and they used it to install this idea of smart street lamps in the city. Another example, also from Bristol, is herb animals. So you have jumping and crawling virtual animals that are projected on walls and flowers, inviting passersby to follow or imitate them. And they are really interactive. So in this case, some Kinect-like cameras systems were used to see whether people were close by, whether they were willing to play. And then, it was monitored what they were doing, and the animations of the animals, the herb animals, was coordinated with their movements. And of course, in order to do so, you have to model the environment so that you have the animations on the right spot. So, okay, here you have another situation also in Bristol with the same project. There have been some ideas to have playful pedestrian crossings, but unfortunately that was not so successful. So here it looks very nice, but in practice what happened was something like this. So it was an painted animation that was shown, painted on your face, like you have it in photo kiosks. And the animations were shown on a display attached to a traffic light pole. Some years ago, 2017, I wrote a paper for the Wall Street Journal, an American United States journal, about how to make cities more fun. And it was, of course, I found it a nice article, but if you look at comments of people who read this article, where I had all these ideas of piano stairs, dancing traffic lights, herb animals animated in the city, then some of the comments were, the article conflates fun with being incessantly distracted by some inane electronic gadget. Or they said, well, are we really presumed by the political and corporate powers that be to be so void of our own interesting internal mental activity that we need to be engaged, etc. Or is it really more sinister than that? That what we are being conditioned to do is to no longer rely on our own internal processes, but do become totally dependent on the stimulation of computerized devices. And someone commented, well, this sounds like the pickpocket's delight. And okay, he may be right. In 2018, also in Leicester, I was in Leicester at the time, and I saw the ideas that consultants came up to make Leicester a more playable city, to bring Leicester to life. And they had similar ideas that I showed in the previous slides. And well, then they asked the citizens, what do you think of this? And yeah, the city needs brightening up, but also they are okay. But is this really the council's priority? And no, we don't want it. It's a waste of time and money. And unfortunately, that was the majority. So if you want to introduce playful technology in the city and playable things, playable events, you have to be very careful, I think. On the other hand, people like to play. And of course, not everybody has to agree with what is happening in the city. So other criticisms. Well, what some people said, rather battle the privatization and control of supposedly public spaces. Well, I think that should be done, certainly, but not instead of. You can do both. Some people commented it's only for children, or if you are an actual infant, yeah. It's delightful but frivolous, one of follies, primarily for adults' pleasure. Well, nothing wrong with that, but okay. What I see is that in these projects, no or hardly use of existing sensors and actuators in the city. So there are no additions to the digital infrastructure and only available for a short time. So that does not really help. And you can also say that the playability is for the creative class. All these examples I had, well, not everyone will be interested in playing with them. Some need some kind of intelligence, and you need to have some time to do it. Moreover, they were not for children, not for disabled persons, and not for the elderly. And you can say a more global opinion is that, well, this is a top-down approach. So there has not been any community involvement. So the city council decides to have these kinds of projects. Only the hacking examples, well, they were bottom up. And you can also see this, if it is a top-down approach or if it is done by large companies like Google's Sidewalk, then, well, this reminds you to a McDonaldization of society or a Googleization of urban play. And we will certainly not want it to be in that way. So, summary and conclusions. We have technology that can facilitate play. We can have interactive urban environments that are playful. We can design them. But what I earlier said about, what Brighton wanted, enabling residents and visitors to reconfigure and rewrite city services, places and stories, that's certainly not the case at this moment. And of course, you have to be very careful with doing this. On the other hand, there is a do-it-yourself and maker movement, tinkerers, hackers, etc. And I think they can play a useful role. They can develop applications and installations that really serve the interests of residents and the local communities, and that can be done in a playful way. And of course, there will be conflicts, you can call it possible conflicts, between top-down, the civic authorities, and bottom-up, the local communities' approaches. So who has access to sensors and actuators, and which sensors and actuators? And of course, as a general remark, different cities, different cultures. But who doesn't want to experience or get involved in everyday playful activities? So all my examples, they were from the United States or from Europe, Western Europe. And of course, situations, cities are different in other countries. Situations are different in, let's say, Delhi in India, or Dhaka in Bangladesh, or Colombo in Sri Lanka. So I hope, nevertheless, despite this criticism and sometimes negative remarks, that people are motivated to work on playable cities. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the informative and interesting keynote, Dr. Neil. And now the audience, if you have any questions for Professor, the floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you for the nice presentation. So I have one question, like when we are working on a smart city, so there may be some privacy concerns, like do smart cities violate people's privacy concerns, like that. So are there any measures that we can take to somehow avoid these privacy violations and other concerns?
Yeah, of course, that's one of the main questions. So if you look at these applications, I mentioned China, for example, you can hardly say that in public spaces, in some of these cities in China, people have privacy. There is no privacy anymore. They have a lot of facial recognition situations, and they monitor your behavior. I don't really like that, but you see that ideas about privacy are changing. Technology is in fact pushing privacy away, I think. And it's also maybe a difference in generations. So my generation is very, very, well, against, let's say, the violation of privacy. But the younger generation using social media, they often have no problem with, well, telling the whole world about what they think and what they do. In fact, they are monitored on their smartphone by other people, by their friends and the bubble they live in. So it's concern, and there are regulations, and you have to look how these regulations will work in situations where you have all these sensors and actuators embedded in cities. But the regulations are completely different in China than in the United States and then in the Netherlands. So that's in fact all I can say about this. I hope it answers. Well, it answers, but at least, yeah, okay.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much.
Hi, Professor Anton. I'm Kasim from UCSC. Thank you very much for your interesting speech. I would like to ask, there are like different approaches that we can build smart cities. So one thing is build those from the scratch, and the other one is like we can gradually improve our like regular kind of city with using IoT and sensors, actuators, so we can gradually improve it to become a smart city. So how do you differentiate, or like how you how you can think of these two approaches? Which approach do you think better? Maybe in my opinion, like I think building from the scratch can be the easier approach, but what do you think, like when thinking of the human factors and other things, maybe the other approach is better? I mean, how do you think about this?
Yeah, okay, that's a very nice question. If you look at the greenfield smart cities, they have been proposed in several countries, and one of them is Songdo in Korea. It's a very well-known smart city. They started from scratch, so they built a new city and an infrastructure that should take care of, well, the control of waste, of energy, traffic flow, things like that. People didn't want to live there at first. There are about, I think at this moment, maybe 100,000 people living there. And it was planned to be for 300,000 persons, people, in 2015, I think. And people did not want to live there. That can change, of course, because there were hardly museums. There were hardly events organized in the city, things like that. That is changing now, but the whole city was built really top down without any involvement of citizens or future citizens. So, and I think that shows that maybe it's better to have existing cities and gradually improve the smartness and the playability of these cities, and always take care that you have communities involved. So it's, of course, a little difficult to say, because, again, this may be different for different countries. But I think you can be more successful if you start with existing cities and maybe learn from that, and then introduce similar technology in these new cities, these greenfield cities.
Thank you, Prof. Enden.
Kasun, thank you. Any more questions, or is the time up? People can always, if they want, send me an email, and I will certainly answer their questions. Or if they want to have certain papers, I can take care that I send these papers to them.
So yeah, if there are no more questions from the audience, I think we can wind up the session. So yeah, before we wind up the session, once again, there's chance for audience if you have any questions to ask. But seems like no more questions. So thank you again, Professor, for sharing your valuable knowledge with us, and also the audience for your enthusiastic engagement. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
And now we can move on to the next item of our agenda. So we'll start our award ceremony shortly. Please stay with us through to the end of this ICTA 2021. Thank you.
Welcome to the new age of intelligence.
I feel the shadows hanging over, but wait, now come closer.
Present only your best. See beyond the ordinary. Collaborate clearer than ever. Work with personalized performance. power every kind of project and change the world for better. The new Latitude family. Welcome to the new age of intelligence. Open a Dell Precision mobile workstation, and a world of opportunity unfolds. Turn your thoughts into breakthroughs. Harness intelligence into results. Expand your boundaries. Get the limitless power to create the world around you, to build tomorrow's innovations today.
Research every product on the market. I mean, pretty much anything there was for point of sale.
We were attracted to the cake system initially because of the entry cost was so low. But then when we got deeper into it and we saw the efficiencies that it added to the business, you can't really put a value on that.
Part of it was like, why didn't I embrace this earlier? And the other part of me saying, thank God I did it and I did it now.
Welcome to Cake, a fully integrated technology platform. Cake technology solutions are built exclusively to meet the unique needs and specific demands for quick serve and full service restaurants.
Thousands of our customers are using these solutions today, and we keep hearing the same things over and over. And that is, this makes their life easier. It helps them run their restaurants better. It helps them succeed.
Mad Mobile's a company that is driven by a passion around mobile and enabling mobile transactions. Every transaction is going to be mobile, whether it's the associate or the server on the floor, or it's the customer or the guest on their own device. Everything's absolutely going to be mobile in the future. And we've teamed up with Apple to try and make it as easy as possible for restaurants, for retailers, and other organizations to get to mobile very quickly. We worked together and figured out, you know, what are the things that we want to do to, you know, empower those associates on the floor? What are the journeys that we want to make sure that we solve? And then how do we get to that data? And how do we integrate closely with those systems of record, in particular, the point of sale system? And together with Apple, we're working with some of the biggest retailers in the world, from here to Japan.
Welcome to the new age of intelligence. Jump in to productivity. Connect to the world around you. See beyond the ordinary. Step up your style. Empower peak performance. Transform every call. Welcome to the new age of intelligence.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have now reached the most awaited segment of the conference, which is announcing the best and the excellent papers of the ICTA 2021. So for this, I invite the publication chair of ICTA 2021, Dr. Kasun Karra Nayaka.
Hello, everyone. As the publication chair of ICTA 2021, I would like to congratulate all the authors who have presented their interested research work in this conference. So, as Thilina pointed out in his welcome speech to the conference, so this year we had a very competitive process of selecting papers for ICTA. So I think in Thilna's speech he has discussed like how rigorous review process we have taken. We have out of 224 submissions, we have accepted only 40 full papers. Out of those 40 full papers, we have selected 10 papers as excellent papers. So those 10 papers were selected by the track chairs of each track. And then we have appointed a best paper committee with six renowned academics in Sri Lanka to review these works and then also to participate in the presentations of those authors, presenting authors. So they have participated for all these presentations and asked questions from these presenters. And then, based on this committee's recommendation, we have selected the best paper of this conference. So first, I will announce the 9 excellent papers that of ICTA 2021. So those are paper ID 9, generalization of LSTM CNN ensemble profiling method with time, series data normalization and regularization. Authors Dishniyas Ratnayaka, Pasindu Pereira, Heshan Eranga, Manjushri Vikramasinghe from University of Colombo School of Computing. The second excellent paper is paper ID 97, Machine Learning Approach for Predicting Career Suitability, Career Progression and Attrition of IT Graduates. Damit Eranga Banneka, Hashini Dhanasekara, Shehana Khan, Anuradha Karunasena, Nadisha Premadasa from SLIIT. Paper ID 103, Suspicious Human Crowd Behavior Detection, a Transfer Learning Approach, authors Pumudu A. Fernando, Peshala R. Lianage from Informatics Institute of Technology. Paper ID 162, TrackNet, a Deep Learning Approach on 3D Curves for Segmenting White Matter. Logiraj Kumara Lingam, Kokul Tanika Salam, Sittapalam Sothishwaran, Nagulan Ratnaraja from University of Jaffna and Eastern University of Sri Lanka. A comparative analysis of clustering techniques with feature selection for breast cancer recurrence prediction, paper ID 232, authored by Hansani S. Pereira, Rangika L. Silva, from University of Sri Jayawardenepura. Paper number 217, Criminal Investigation and Management System Using CCTV Footage, Eagle Eye, Devmal Fernando, Praveen Fernando, Givindu Pereira, Kasun Gunatilaka from Sri Lanka Institute of Information Technology. Paper ID 112, Period Prediction of Sinhala Epigraphical Scripts Using Convolutional Neural Networks, Pabasara Surasingha, Kokul Tanika Salam from University of Vavuniya. Paper ID 16, Party-Based Sentiment Analysis Pipeline for the Legal Domain, Sahan Jayasingha, Lakit Rambukkanage, Ashan Silva, Nisansa Di Silva, Amal Shehan Pereira from University of Moratuwa. Paper ID 19, Seeking Sinhala Sentiment, Predicting Facebook Reactions of Sinhala Post, authored by Vihanga Jayavikrama, Gihan, R.A. Veera Parameshwara, Nisansa Di Silva, Yugandhya Vijayaratna from University of Moratuwa. So those are the 9 excellent papers. So we are planning to invite this 9 excellent paper and the best paper of the ICTR 2021 for the ICTA journal special issue, which is going to be published in the next year. So now I'm going to announce the best paper of this year's conference. So that will be the paper ID 102, Minimize Traffic Congestion with Emergency Facilitation Using Deep Reinforcement Learning, authored by Dulmina Kondagoda, UDI Pereira, Prabhash Kumarasingha, Gihan P. Senaviratna from University of Colombo School of Computing. So as the publication chair of the conference, I would like to congratulate all of these authors, and you will receive the best paper certificate and the excellent paper certificates in the near future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Karunanayake. I congratulate all the authors and presenters of the papers which won the Excellent and the Best Paper Awards, and also everyone who participated in the conference and presented their papers. All of you have got a publication. Congratulations on your efforts. So with that, we are moving on to the conference closing speech, which will be given by ICTA 2021 co-chairperson, Mr. Viraj Vergama. I kindly invite Mr. Vergama to deliver the closing speech.
Okay, thank you, Dushani. Very good evening, all of you. As one of the co-chair of this conference, I am pleased to speak to you to the conclusion of the 21st International Conference on Advances in ICT for Emerging Regions, ICTA 2021. Conducted by the University of Colombo School of Computing, Sri Lanka. As Dr. Thilina mentioned at the very first day, we received 224 papers this time, and 40 out of those submissions were presented as full papers during last 2 days. Other than those 40 papers, we had 6 excellent keynote speeches, 2 invited talks, and 13 poster presentations during today and yesterday. Due to the prevailing situation all over the world, owing to the COVID-19 pandemic, we conducted ICTA 2020 last year 100% online, but that is for the first time in the history, but this time we step ahead and managed to conduct the ICTA 2021 in blended mode, both online and physically. So we would like to congratulate the best paper winner, excellent paper certificate receivers, and all the other authors who have presented papers in this year ICTA 2021 conference. As you all know, these 2.5 days were not simply appearing, but this is the outcome of a tremendous work carried out by a fully dedicated team during last few months. So on behalf of the ICTA 2021 co-chairs, I would like to say thank you for all of those who work very hard to get this done up to this level, including the director UCSC, Professor K.P. Hewagamage, for his excellent guidance and all the approval required to conduct this conference, and also the deputy director of UCSC, Dr. Ajanta Thakorala, and the head of postgraduate studies, Professor Prasad Vimalaratna, as well as all the academics and non-academics of the UCSC, for their immense contribution given throughout the year on organizing this annual event of the UCSC. My special thanks should go to our conference secretaries, Ms. Nimali Vasana, Sanduni Triyamavithana, and Amali Pereira, who work days and nights to arrange all the things needed to run this conference. Thank you, all of you. Further, thank you very much all the reviewers who spend their time on reviewing papers we received, especially Mr. Pasindu Marasinghe and Isuru Nanayakkar for their very dedicated work on reviewing the papers. Then I would like to appreciate the work done by keynote and invited talk speakers, best paper selection committee members, as well as all the panelists in the panel discussion we had today for their time and contribution to make this event very success. IEEE Sri Lanka section, our technical co-sponsor, Softlogic IT, the platinum sponsor of ICTA 2021, Cake Engineering, Limark Technology, and NGRA, our co-sponsors of the event, thank you very much for your support on conducting this year's conference. All these visible outcomes of the conference during last 2 days were there because of our experts at the ADMTC team, UCSC, led by Dr. Samantha Matararachi, Achinta, Anjali, Geetika, Oshan, and Tharindu and Pragita as well. Their very dedicated work make this event success. So thank you very much all of you for your support throughout the conference in 2021. All the leaders and members of all the subcommittees, thank you very much. We know that you work very hard to get this done to this level, and you were the pillars of this event. So thank you very much. And all the heads and all the staff of the UCSC divisions like postgraduate, engineering, finance, NOC, academic, and admin, thank you very much for all of your great support during last few months. So I hope that you all had a very pleasant and memorable 2.5 days in this conference. Further, I hope that you all would have shared as well as taken back with you the knowledge you gained through this conference, and that would further research in the domain of ICT. Okay, with that conclusive remarks, now I hereby declare the ICTA 2021 International Conference on Advances in ICT for Emerging Regions closed. Thank you very much for all of you. Have a great evening.
Changing rapidly in front of our eyes. While new technologies are being built, tons of data is created every second. Industry needs are changing and businesses need to innovate ever so fast. Are you equipped to face the transformations taking place around you? We can help you achieve it. That is what inspires us. This is Limark Technologies. We're a talented and experienced pool of software architects, engineers and data scientists have come together to produce world-class software solutions. We are a global technology company specializing in product engineering, data analytics, DevOps, quality engineering, IoT and cloud frameworks, and our unique service model of CTO Office as a Service. We offer a personalized journey management system for career progression for the Limark team. We go an extra mile to deliver excellence, delight our customers, and ensure successful project delivery. Our team can become the trusted partner to create your next success story. Limark Technologies, for a mark of excellence.
Welcome to the new age of intelligence.
I feel the shadows hanging over, but wait, now come closer.
Present only your best. See beyond the ordinary. Collaborate clearer than ever. Work with personalized performance. Power every kind of project. And change the world for better. The new Latitude family. Welcome to the new age of intelligence.
Open a Dell Precision mobile workstation, and a world of opportunity unfolds. Turn your thoughts into breakthroughs. Harness intelligence into results. Expand your boundaries. Get the limitless power to create the world around you, to build tomorrow's innovations today.